Welcome to the first session of the CFR Fall 2021 Academic Webinar Series. I'm Irina Faskanis, Vice President of the National Program and Outreach at CFR. Today's meeting is on the record and the video and transcript will be available on our website, cfr.org/academic, if you would like to share it with your colleagues or classmates. As always, CFR takes no institutional positions on matters of policy. We're delighted to have Travis Adkins and Brenda Gayle Plummer with us to discuss race in America and international relations. Travis Adkins is Deputy Assistant Administrator in the Bureau of Africa at USAID and lecturer of African and Security Studies at the Walsh School of Foreign Service and in the Prisons and Justice Initiative at Georgetown University. As an international development leader, he has two decades of experience working in governance, civil society, and refugee and migration affairs in over 50 nations throughout Africa and the Middle East. Mr. Adkins was a CFR International Affairs Fellow and is a CFR member. Dr. Brenda Gayle Plummer is a professor of history at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. Her research includes race and gender, international relations, and civil rights. Dr. Plummer has taught Afro-America history throughout her 20 years of experience in higher education. Previously, she taught at Fisk University, the University of California, Santa Barbara, and the University of Minnesota. And from 2001 to 2005, Dr. Plummer served on the Historical Advisory Committee of the US Department of State. So thank you both for being with us today. We appreciate you taking the time to share your thoughts with us. Travis, I thought we could begin with you to talk about the ways in which you've seen race relations in America influence US foreign policy.
Sure, thank you so much, Irina, and welcome to everyone. Thank you for joining. The first thing I would say is that America's long history of violence, exclusion, and barbarism towards Black people and indigenous people and Asian communities and immigrant communities in the United States have worked to give the lie to the notion of who we say we are in terms of freedom, in terms of democracy, in terms of the respect for human rights. And these are the core messages that we seek to project in our foreign policy. We've not been able to resolve those contradictions because we have refused to face this history, right? We can't countenance a historical narrative in which we are not the heroes, not the good guys, not on the right side of history. And the challenge that we've had is that we've seen that play out in so many ugly ways domestically, but it also has resonance and relevance in our foreign policy, because what it ends up doing is essentially producing a foreign policy of platitudes and contradictory posturing on the issues of human rights, on the issues of racial justice, on the issues of democratic governance, when the world can see not only this history, but this present reality of racial discrimination, of police brutality, of efforts to suppress the political participation of specific groups of people inside of America. They can see children in cages at the southern border. They can see anti-Asian hate taking place in our nation. And they can hear those messages resounding, sometimes from our White House, sometimes from our Senate, sometimes from our Congress and other halls of power throughout the United States. And that works against the message of who we say we are, which is really who we want to be. But the thing that we, I think, lose out on is pretending that where we want to be is actually where we are. And I think back a couple of weeks ago, Secretary Blinken came out saying to diplomats in the State Department that it was okay for them to admit America's flaws and failings in their diplomatic engagements with other countries. But I do applaud that, but I also think that saying that we would admit it to the rest of the world already knows. And who we would have to and need to focus on admitting it to is ourselves, because we have not faced this national shame of ours as it relates to the historical and the present reality of white supremacy, of racialized violence and hatred and exclusion in our immigration policy, in our education policy, in our law and customs and cultural mores that have helped to produce ongoing violence and hatred of this nature in which our history is steeped. I think the other part of that is that we lose the opportunity to then share that message with the rest of the world. And so what I like to say is that our real history is better than the story that we tell. So instead of us framing ourselves in our foreign policy as a nation who fell from the heavens to the top of a mountain, it's a more powerful story to say that we climbed up out of a valley and are still climbing up out of a valley of trying to create and produce and cultivate a multiracial, multi-ethnic democracy with respect for all, and that that is and has been a struggle. And I think that that message is much more powerful. And what it does is it creates healing for us at home, but it also begins to take away this kind of Achilles heel that many of our adversaries have used historically, the Soviet Union, now Russia, China, Iran. This notion that democracy and freedom and the moral posturing of America is all for naught. If you just look at what they do at home, who are they to preach to you about these things when they themselves have the same challenges? And so I think that we would strengthen ourselves if we could look at this in that way. And I would just close by saying that, you know, we often speak of the civil rights movement and the movement for decolonization in the world, and specifically in Africa, where I mostly work, speak of them in the past tense. But I would argue that both of them are movements and histories that are continuously unfolding, that are not resolved, and that haven't brought themselves to peaceful kinds of conclusions. And this is why, when George Floyd is killed on camera, choked for 9 minutes and loses his life, that you see reverberations all over the world, people pushing back because they are suffering from the same in their countries. And they are following after anti-Asian hate protesters and advocates, Black Lives Matter advocates and protesters, people who are saying to the world, this is unacceptable. And so even in that way, you see the linked fates that people share. And so I think that the more we begin to face who we are at home, the more we begin to heal these wounds and relate better in the foreign policy arena, because I think that it is a long-held fallacy that these things are separate, right? A nation's foreign policy is only an extension of its beliefs, its policies, its aspirations, and its desires from home going out into the world. And so I'll stop there and thank you for the question.
Thank you very much. Dr. Plummer, over to you.
Mm-hmm. Your question is a very good one. It's also a very book-length question. But I'll try to address that. First of all, I'd like to say that I find Mr. Adkins' statement quite eloquent and can't think of anything I disagree with in what he has said. There are a couple of things that we might consider as well. I think there are several issues embedded in this question of the relationship between race relations in the United States and its policies toward other countries. One of them is, I think there's a difference between what policymakers intend and how American policy is perceived. There is also the question of precisely who is making and carrying out U.S. foreign policy. Now, there was a time when that question could be very readily answered. But we're now in an age where, you know, we have enhanced roles for the military and the intelligence community. We have private contractors executing American objectives overseas. And this really places a different spin on things, somewhat different from what we observe when we look at this only through a strictly historical lens. I think we also need to spend some time thinking about the precise relationship between race and racism and what we might call colonial or imperialist practices. Might look, for example, at what is the relationship between the essentially colonial status of places like Puerto Rico and the Marianas, and how those particular people from those places are perceived and treated within both the insular context and the domestic context. Clearly, everybody on the planet is shaped to a large degree by the culture and the society that they live in, that they grew up in, right? And it is probably no mystery from the standpoint of attitudes that certain kinds of people domestically may translate into similar views of people overseas. But I think one of the things we might want to think about is how are institutions as well as prejudices influencing what takes place. People like to talk, for example, about the similarities between the evacuation of Saigon, the evacuation of Kabul, and wonder what is it called when you do the same thing over and over again and expect different results. We might want to think about what is it institutionally which creates these kinds of repetitions, creates situations in which diplomats are forced to apologize and explain continually about race and other conflictual issues in American society. We might also think about what you perhaps could call a racialization process. Do we create categories of pariahs in response to national emergencies? Do we create immigrants from countries to the south of the United States as enemies because we don't have a comprehensive and logical way of dealing with immigration? Do we create enemies out of Muslims because of our roles in the Middle East and the activities and actions of other states? There's some historical precedents for this, the internment of Japanese Americans during World War II, for example. So it seems to me that in addressing, I think, some of this very rich question, there are a number of ways and facets that we might want to look at and discuss more fully.
Great, thank you very much. Now we're going to go to all of you for questions and comments. So you can either ask your question by raising your hand, click on the raised hand icon, and I will call on you, or else you can write your question in the Q&A box. And if you choose to write your question, although we prefer to hear your voice, please include your affiliation. And when I call on you, please let us know who you are and your institution. So the first raised hand I see is from Stanley Gasek.
Yes, thank you very much. Thank you very much, Professor Plummer and Mr. Adkins for very, very compelling presentation. My name is Stanley Gasek. I'm the Senior Advisor for Global Strategies at the United Food and Commercial Workers International Union, representing 1.3 million working women and men in the United States and Canada in the retail, wholesale, food production, healthcare, and services industries. practically all of our members are on the front lines of the pandemic. I also served as deputy director and interim director of the ILO mission in Brazil from 2011 to 2016. And my question is this: I wonder if the speakers would also acknowledge that an issue for the United States in terms of its credibility with regard to racial justice, human rights, and of course, labor rights, is a rather paltry record of the United States in terms of ratifying international instruments and adhering to international forum with regard to all of these issues. One example which comes to mind in my area is ILO Convention 111 against discrimination in employment and profession, which could actually has gone through a certain due diligence process in former administrations and was agreed to by business and labor in the United States, but still the United States has failed to ratify. I just wondered if you might comment more generally about how that affects our credibility in terms of advocating for racial justice, human rights, and labor rights throughout the world. Thank you very much.
Who can address that? Like to address that?
Well, I have very little immediate knowledge of this, and I have to say that labor issues and labor rights have been kind of a missing element in terms of being heavily publicized and addressed. I think it has something to do with the fact that over the course of the decades, the United States has been less responsive to the United Nations, to international organizations in general. But in terms of the specifics, you know, precisely what has fallen by the wayside, I personally don't have knowledge about that.
And I would just say more generally, not to speak specifically in terms of labor, where I'm also not an expert, but there is, of course, a long history of the U.S. Seeking to avoid these kinds of issues in the international arena writ large, as Dr. Plummer was just referring to. I just finished a book by Carol Anderson called Eyes Off the Prize, which is a whole study of this and the ways in which the U.S. government worked through the United Nations to prevent the internationalization of the civil rights movement, which many, Malcolm X and Martin Luther King and Fannie Lou Hamer and others, sought to frame it in the context of human rights and raise it into an international specter. And that was something that the U.S. government did not want to happen. And of course, we know that part of the genius of the civil rights movement writ large was this tactic of civil disobedience, not just to push against a law that we didn't like to see in effect, but actually to create a scene that would create international media attention, which would show to the world what these various communities were suffering inside of America, to try to create pressure outside of our borders for the cause of freedom and justice and democracy. And so there is that long history there, which you've touched on with your question. Thank you for that.
Thank you. I'm going to go next to Majubalu Alufunke Okome.
Good afternoon, and thank you for your presentation. I just wonder about U.S. Foreign policy, how it lines up with the domestic politics, you know, in terms of race relations. Because if one was to believe U.S. propaganda, you know, this country is doing good in the world. It's the country to emulate. But, you know, the events of, well, I guess the George Floyd case brought into graphic relief what most astute observers of the US No, that race relations in the U.S. do not line up very well with the constitutional aspirations of the U.S. So what's going to change now? You know, and then there's also this pandemic and the way in which race and class is showing us about the real serious inequalities in the U.S. So what's going to change in terms of lessons learned? And then moving forward, is also multilateralism going to come back into U.S. foreign policy in some way? That's it.
I'm getting kind of an echo here. I don't know if other people are. I don't think anyone is, you know, who is thinking about this seriously doubts that the United States is in a crisis at the moment, a crisis of legitimacy, not only abroad, but also domestically. We have a situation in which an ostensibly developed country has large pockets, geographic pockets, where there are 30, 40, 50% poverty rates. We have people who are essentially mired in superstition, with regard to, you know, matters of health and science. I don't think anyone is, thinking about this with any degree of gravity is not concerned about the situation. Once again, I think we're talking here about institutions, about how we can avoid this sort of repetitive and cyclical behavior. But now, one thing I want to say about George Floyd is that this is a phenomenon that is not only unique to the United States. One of the reasons why George Floyd became an international cause célèbre is because people in other countries also were experiencing racism. Other countries had issues with regard to immigration. And so we're really looking at a situation which I think is, transcends the domestic, but also transcends simply looking at the United States as sort of target of criticism.
Do you want to add anything, Travis, or do you want to? Should we go to the next question?
Go on to the next question. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Let's go to Sharik Zafar with Georgetown. And our prior questioner was with Brooklyn, teaches at Brooklyn College.
Hey there, this is Sharik Zafar. I was formerly the special counsel for post 9/11 national origin discrimination in the Department of Justice Civil Rights Division. Sorry, that's a mouthful. And then most recently during the Obama years, I was a special representative to Muslim communities. So I first applaud the presentations. These issues are very near and dear to me. I think it's clear, we have to own up and acknowledge our shortcomings. And I think I was really sad to hear that we actually worked against highlighting what I think is really an example of American exceptionalism, which is our civil rights movement and our civil rights community. When I was at State during the Obama years, we had a very modest program where we brought together US civil rights leaders and connected them with European civil rights leaders. And then the idea wasn't that we had it all figured out, but rather that, in some respects, the United States has made some advances when it comes to civil rights organizing and civil society development in that respect, perhaps more so than other countries. I was just thinking, I'd love to get the panelists' thoughts on ways that we can continue to collaborate and, on a civil society level between civil rights organizations in the United States and abroad, and the way the U.S. government should actually support that, even if it means highlighting our shortcomings, but as a way to, you know, invest in these types of linkages and partnerships to not only highlight our shortcomings, but look for ways that we could, you know, actually come to solutions that need to be, I think, fostered globally. Thanks so much.
You know, the first thing I would say, Shark, thanks for your question. I thought it was interesting, this idea of framing the civil rights movement as a kind of example of American exceptionalism. And I think there's a way in which I would relate to that in the sense that folks did, at least nominally or notionally, have certain kinds of freedom of speech, certain kinds of rights to assembly. But even those were challenged, of course, when we see the violence and the assassinations and all of the machinations of the government against those who were leaders or participants in that movement. And so in that sense, perhaps I would agree. I might push back, though, in terms of American exceptionalism as it relates to civil rights, because these people were actually advocating against the U.S. government, who actually did not want them to have the rights that they were promised under the Constitution. And of course, many of us would not be free or able to speak up without the 13th and 14th and 15th Amendments. And so there's a sense in which we celebrate them, but there's also a sense in which they are actually indictments of the original Constitution, which did not consider any of those things to be necessary elements of our society. In terms of civil society and where the US government is engaged, I think that, you know, sometimes when we deal with these problems that are foreign policy related, you know, sometimes the answer is at home. Sometimes the answer is not, you know, a white paper from some high level think tank. It's not something that starts 10,000 miles away from where we are, because I don't think that we would have the kind of standing and credibility that we would need to say that we believe in and support and give voice and our backing to civil society movements abroad if we don't do the same thing at home. And so everything that we want to do somewhere else, we ought to ask ourselves the question of whether or not we've thought about doing it at home. And I don't mean to suggest, because certainly no nation is perfect and every nation has its flaws, but certainly we would be called to the mat for the ways in which we are either acknowledging or refusing to acknowledge that we have, you know, these same challenges. And so I think there still remains a lot of work to be done there in terms of how we engage on this. And you have seen the State Department come out and be more outspoken. You've seen the Biden administration putting these issues more out front. You've now seen the Black Lives Matter flag flying over U.S. embassies in different parts of the world. And some people might view that as a co-optation of a movement that is actually advocating against the government for those rights and those respects and that safety and security that people believe that they are not receiving. And others might see it as a way to say, look, our nation is embracing civil society and civic protests in our nation as an example that the countries in which those embassies are in should be more open to doing the same kinds of things. And so it's a great question. I think it remains to be seen how we move forward on that score.
Thank you. I'm going to go next to Molly Cole.
Hi, my name is Molly Cole. I am a grad student of global affairs at New York University. I was just curious sort of what y'all thought about what the consequences of foreign policy on punishment systems and institutions as it pertains to race relations in the United States would be also in tandem with sort of this stride for global inclusivity and equity and just sort of, I guess, hitting those two ideas against each other.
Can you clarify the ideals for us, Molly? So one sounded like it was about maybe mass incarceration or the death penalty or things of that nature. You talk about punitive systems of justice. And then the others seem to be more about diversity, equity, and inclusion in the foreign policy space. But I don't want to put words in your mouth. Just want to make sure I understand the question.
You hit the nail on the head.
Okay. Do you want to go ahead, Dr. Plummer?
Again, a great question, but I could write a book to answer. if you're talking about the sort of international regime of incarceration, is that what you were referring to?
Yes, essentially. So when we're considering, these punitive systems, I'm thinking in terms of, the death penalty, mass incarceration, private prisons, sort of this culmination of us trying to come up with these ideals, but doing it sort of on our own while also combating, what the nation is calling for, or what the globe is calling for.
Yeah. I think this sort of pertains to what I had mentioned earlier about who is making and carrying out U.S. foreign policy or domestic policy for that matter. There's a whole question of state and what parts of the state are involved in this whole question of incarceration and are involved in the whole question of the death penalty. One of the things that we are aware of is that prisons have, some of the prisons are actually not being operated by civil authorities. They're operated by private entities. And we saw this again in, particularly in Afghanistan, where a lot of functions which normally, are carried out by civil authorities are carried out by private authorities. And so this really puts a whole different perspective on the question of the relationship of citizens to the state. And to any other particular group of citizens to the state. So I think that one of the the problem areas then is to tease out what in fact are the obligations and privileges of government, and how do they differ from and how are they distinguished from the private sector?
And I would just add
go ahead.
Quickly. On this notion of hypocrisy and saying one thing and doing another, there was an interesting anecdote around this when President Obama visited Senegal, and he was delivering a fairly tough message about the treatment of members of the LGBT plus community in Senegal. And President Macky Sall got up essentially after President Obama and was essentially saying, we kind of appreciate this tough love lecture, but I would remind you, that Senegal doesn't have the death penalty, right? And so on one hand, we're actually saying something that has a grounding. Of course, people of all human stripes should have dignity and have respect and be protected. But he is then hitting back and saying, hey, wait a minute, you kill people who break laws in your own country, and we don't have the death penalty. So who should actually be the arbiter of how is the correct way or what is the correct way to be? On the second part of your question, quickly, Molly, especially as it relates to the kind of diversity, equity, and inclusion piece, this is why also there's been a big push to look in our State Department, to look at USAID, to look at the face that America presents to the world. And all too often, that face has been male, that face has been white, and that gives a certain perception of America, but it also means that we lose the tremendous treasure and talent of people who have language skills, who come from communities in which their own perspective on the world actually is a talent that they have, specifically because many of those communities, whether they've immigrated or come to America by different means, are also from groups who've been marginalized, who've been oppressed, who have a certain frame and a lens with which to engage with other nations in the world, either in terms of partnership, either in terms of deterrence. And so we lose out in many ways because we haven't done a great job in that matter.
I'm going to take a written question from Morton Holbrook, who's at Kentucky Wesleyan College. His question is, how should the United States respond to international criticism to the U.S.'s racial discrimination, and how will that affect the relationship between the U.S. and the international community?
Well, the United States, I think, has no choice but to acknowledge this. Historically, this has been a problem that when pressed on this issue in the past, the response was always, well, we know this is a problem and we're working on it. And the most egregious examples of racism are the responsibility of people who are either at the margins of society or who represent some sort of a relic past that is rapidly disappearing, right? You know, that was the message about the South, right? That, okay, the South is, you know, rapidly developing, and so soon these vestiges of violent racism will be over, right? The reason why that doesn't work anymore is because we're always projecting this future, right? That it's always being projected further and further into the future, right? We're never there yet, right? And it seems to me, again, that this is a problem of institutions. It's a problem of the embeddedness of racism in American life, and a refusal on the part of so many Americans to acknowledge that racism is real and that it exists. I think we see many examples of this. I'm thinking of one instance where a George Floyd commemorative mural was painted on a sidewalk, and some folks came along with some paint and painted over it because they said there wasn't any racism. Right? While engaged in a racist act. So there really needs to be, I think, on a very fundamental level, some education, in this country on the issue of race and racism. The question is, who will be the leaders, right? Who will undertake this kind of mission.
Yeah. One thing I would say quickly on that arena, just an anecdote as well, that also relates to really in some ways the last question about who our representatives are and what perspective they bring. Several years ago, I was on a trip, congressional delegation to Egypt, and I was with several members of the CBC, and we met with President Sisi. And they were giving him a fairly rough go of it over his treatment of protesters who were protesting at that time in Tahrir Square, many of whom had been killed, maimed, abused, jailed. And he listened to them kind of haranguing him. And at the end of that speech that they were giving to him, he said, basically, I understand your points. And I hear your perspective, but he said, can I ask you a question? They said, sure, Mr. President, we welcome you to ask questions. And he said, what about Ferguson? And the day that he said that, Ferguson was on fire with surplus military equipment in the streets of America, with, you know, tear gas and armed military appearing soldiers in the streets of America who were seen, at least optically, to be doing the same thing, right? Not as many people were killed, certainly. But the point was, you have this same problem. However, if that had been a different delegation, he might have scored a point in their verbal jousting. But President Sisi had the misfortune of saying this to two dozen 70 plus year old Black people. And no one in America would know better than they what that is like. And so what they ended up replying to him by saying, exactly, no one knows this better than we do. And this is exactly why we're telling you that you shouldn't do it. Not because our country doesn't have that history, but because we do have that history and it has damaged us and it will damage you, which takes on a completely different tone in our foreign relations than if it was simply a lecture and that we were placing ourselves above the nations of the world rather than among them.
Thank you. I'm going to go to Ashanti Smith.
Hello, can you guys hear me?
We can.
Yes.
Okay, perfect. Hi, my name is Ashanti Smith. I am a grad student at Winston-Salem State University. In regards to some of the responses that you guys gave earlier, it gave me a question. And I wanted to know how you guys were putting the correlation between racism and immigration.
The United States has a history of racialized responses to immigrants, including historically to white immigrants. Back in the day, the Irish, for example, were considered to be, something less than white, right? We know, however, that American society has since, incorporated Europeans into the category of whiteness, and not done so for immigrants from Latin America, Asia, and Africa, who remain racialized, who are perceived as being, in some respects, by some people, unassimilable. We also have a phenomenon of the racialization of Muslims, the creation of outcast groups that are subjected to extremes of surveillance or exclusion or discrimination. Immigration is very much embedded in this. It's a question of an original vision of the United States. And you can see this in the writings of many of the founding fathers as essentially a white country. In which others, are varying degrees of second class citizens or not citizens at all. So this is, an example of something that we have inherited historically that continues to be an issue for us in the present.
Thank you. I'm going to go next to Pearl Robinson.
Hello, I am just so thrilled to see the two panelists here. I actually raised my hand when you were talking about the labor rights issue. And I'm at Tufts University, and I'm currently working on an intellectual biography about Ralph Bunche. And I actually ran over here from the UN archives, where I was actually reading about these issues. And I wanted to just say that the discussion we're having now, it's sort of disjointed because we're dealing with lots of erasures, things that are overlooked. And there are not enough Carol Andersons and Brenda Gayle Plummer professors out there putting these things in press. But even more importantly, they are not sufficiently in our curriculum. So people who study international relations and people who do international relations don't know most of these things. So my quick point I just wanted to say was during World War II, when Ralph Bunche was working for the OSS, Military Intelligence, his archives are full of it. He went and he was interviewing our allies at their missions and embassies in the US, the French, the British, asking them, what are your labor relations policies in your colonial territories? And this was considered important military information for the United States as we were going to be, as Africa was an important field of operation. When you get to actually setting up the UN, I was struck in a way I hadn't because I hadn't read archives this way, but I'm looking at conversations between Bunche and Hammarskjöld, and they're restructuring the organization of the United States, of the United Nations. And there are two big issues that are determining their response to the restructuring, the Cold War, as well as decolonization. And I actually think that those two issues remain. They're structuring the conversation we're having right now. And we say the Cold War is over, but I love this phrase of the racialization of the current enemies or people we think of enemies. So I actually do think that this is a really good program we're having where we're trying to have the conversation, but the disjunctures and the silences and the difficulties of responding, I think speak volumes. The last thing I will say very quickly, that incident about the discussion with President Sisi, that Mr. that needs to be canned. That needs to be somehow made available as an example that can be replicated and expanded and broadened for people to use in teaching.
Well, I always listen when my teacher is talking to me, Dr. Robinson. Thank you for sharing that. And I'm working on it, I promise.
Thank you. I'm going to go next to, we have lots of questions raised hands and we're not going to get to all of you. So I apologize right now. We'll do the best we can. Jill Humphreys.
Hello. My name is Jill Humphreys and I'm an adjunct assistant professor in the Africana Studies program at University of Toledo. And I've been doing Africa-based work, I'm proud to say, for about 33 years, starting at the age of 22, and have used Dr. Plummer's work in my dissertation. And hello, fellow ICAPer. My question is this. There's an assumption that I believe we're operating in, and that is race and racism is somehow aberrant to the founding of this country, right? So we know that Siddhartha Hartman and Frank Wilderson, the Afro-pessimist, make the argument that it is clearly key, that it is fundamental to the development of our institutions. And so my question is this, in the domestic scene, the sort of abolitionists clearly state that unless we fundamentally transform our norms and values, which impact, of course, our institutions, then we will continue to have the exact outcomes that are expected. The killing of George Floyd and the continuing need to kill Black bodies is essential to this country. And so my question is, in the context of foreign relations, international relations, are we also looking at the way in which, number one, it is not aberrant that race and racism is a constitutive element in the development of our foreign policy and our institutions, and that unless we fundamentally first state it, acknowledge it, and then perhaps explore the way in which we dismantle those norms and values that then impact these institutions, that we're going to continue to have the same outcomes, right? So for example, when Samantha Powers visited Ethiopia, if you've been following that whole narrative, there was a major backlash by the Ethiopian diaspora, major. My colleagues and friends, I've had intense conversations, right, around that. Same thing about the belief about Susan, Susan Rice's role, right, in continuing to influence our foreign policy, particularly towards the Horn of Africa. So my question is, what does that look like, both theoretically and conceptually, but more important for me because I'm a practitioner on the ground, what does that look like in practice? And that's where I think Professor Adkins working for USAID could really kind of talk about. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, you know, I think it goes back to Dr. Robinson's question a moment ago, and that is first, the acknowledgement and the calling out and the putting into relief and contrast the context in which we are operating, especially when you think about not even USAID specifically, but the industry of development aid and development assistance kind of writ large, because essentially what we have is a historical continuum that starts with the colonial masters and the colonial subjects. And then that becomes what is called or framed as the first world and the third world, right? And then that becomes the developing world and the developed world. Then that becomes the global north and the global south, all of which suggest that one is above and one is below, that one is a kind of earthly heaven, the other a kind of earthly hell, that one possesses the knowledge and enlightenment to lead people into civilization, and the other needs redemption, needs to be saved, needs to be taught the way to govern themselves, right? That this kind of Western notion of remaking yourself in the world, that your language, that your system of government, that your way of thinking and religion and belief and economics should be the predominant one in the world. And so I think to me, what you're saying suggests the ways in which we should question that. And this is where you start to hear conversations about decolonizing aid, about questioning how we presume to be leaders in the world in various aspects of which we may not actually be producing sound results ourselves. And thinking again about this notion of placing ourselves among nations rather than above nations in the ways in which we relate and engage. And I think that it's one of the reasons that we continue to have challenges in the realm of development assistance, in the realm of our diplomacy and foreign policy, because again, there's a pushback against that kind of thinking, which is rooted in a deep history that contains much violence and many types of economic and diplomatic pressures to create and sustain a set of power relations, which keeps one group of people in one condition and one in another. And so it's a huge question and how to bring that kind of lofty thinking down to the granular level, I think is something that we will have to continue to work on every day. I certainly don't have the answers, but I'm certainly asking the questions.
Think about, we might also think about who is in charge. And this is, you know, goes back to something that we were talking about before. When U.S. foreign policy, you know, is no longer exclusively rooted in the State Department. So in terms of, you know, who represents the United States abroad and in what ways, and how is that representation perceived? We're really looking at, you know, a lot of different actors. And we're also looking at, you know, changes in the way that the U.S. government itself is perceiving its role both at home and abroad. And one of the questions was previously asked about the system of incarceration speaks to that, because we have to ask ourselves what are the proper roles and responsibilities and burdens of the state, the government. And you know what is leased out for in some ways for profit to private concerns. So I think that, you know, some of this is about, you know, a sense of mission that I don't see out there, but I think will in some respects have to be restored and reinvented.
Thank you. I'm going to go next to Erez Manella.
Thank you very much for this really terrific and important panel. My name is Erez Manella. I teach the history of U.S. foreign relations at Harvard. And My question actually, I don't know if Irina planned this, but it follows on directly from the previous question, because I kept on wondering during this panel, there's the focus that we've had here, the topic that's been defined is the way in which domestic race relations, domestic racism have shaped U.S. foreign policy. But of course, U.S. foreign policy has been shaped, as the previous questioner noted, has been shaped directly by racism and perceptions of racial hierarchy since the very beginning. And Professor Adkins spoke very eloquently about, and of course, Professor Plummer has written eloquently about that, including in her books on Haiti and international relations. But I guess I'm wondering if you could speak more about the specifics about the history that needs to be recognized in that realm. And then this is maybe self-interested, whether you have any recommendations in the way that you recommended Carol Anderson's really terrific book for reading that we can read ourselves or give our students to read that would really drive that point home, the influence of racism, race perceptions, race hierarchies themselves directly on the conduct of U.S. foreign relations historically.
Well, Professor Manella, I appreciate your own work on Wilson. That in some respects, that would be a book that I recommend. might also think about Mary Duziak's work on Cold War civil rights and her Law Review article, Segregation as a Cold War Imperative, which directly address these questions. What I would like to see is some work that will perhaps not necessarily an historical perspective, but will address this whole question of the sort of growing, I don't know what you call it, multiplicity or multivariate character of American policy making. As we go forward, past the Cold War era. There's an interesting item by a man named Andrew Friedman, who wrote a book called Covert Capital, and I think the subtitle is something like Landscapes of Power, in which he discusses the rise of Northern Virginia as what he sees as the true capital of parts of the U.S. government in being a center for the military and for the intelligence community and their shaping of that environment at home, as well as their influence in shaping a U.S. policy abroad. So there is a lot of room for work on these issues.
And I would also just follow up and thank you for the question and add another book that I just finished, Daniel Immerwahr from Northwestern University's How to Hide an Empire, which deals in many ways with U.S. foreign policy, the way in which it is explicitly racialized and the ways in which that goes understudied in our policy circles and certainly in the world of education.
I'm going to try to squeeze in one last question, and I apologize again for not getting to everybody's question. We'll go to Garvey Goldburn as our final question.
Yes, hi, can you hear me?
We can.
Hi, my name is Garvey Goldburn. I'm a student at the University of Virginia, actually studying abroad this semester in Rabat, Morocco. And my question to you both is, what mechanisms do we have to reorient the narratives that our foreign policy leaders are brought up with, thinking particularly of American exceptionalism and how we kind of place ourselves on a political pedestal, whether they be foreign affairs schools or various institutions at different levels of American education? What tools do we have to address the foundations of American perspectives of themselves and our nation in relation to the rest of the world, particularly the global South?
wants to go first? An easy question, of course, to close with.
Go ahead, Mr. Adkins.
Sure, sure. Thank you for your question, Garvey, and congratulations on the move out to Morocco. Great to see you there. I think the first thing I would say, of course, is our tools, as far as I am concerned, relate certainly to education. And it's one of the reasons that I am in the classroom. But I know what that fight is like, because even education is taken over by these notions of white supremacy, by these notions of singular historical narratives. And this is why there's been such a push against the 1619 Project of the New York Times, why there is this kind of silly season around the misunderstood origins and context of critical race theory. There is this battle over who gets to tell the story of what America is, because it is more than, but it is more than one thing, obviously, to a multiplicity of people. And so I am kind of remiss, or not remiss, there's no way for me to elucidate for you now a series of tools that will resolve these problems, because these are challenges that people have been wrestling with before our mothers' mothers were born. And so we only continue in that fight from where we sit, and certainly in the classrooms that I am in, whether they are in prisons or on campuses, we are always digging into the origin of these things. And the mainframe through which I teach is not just for students to understand this history for their health, but for them to understand this history as a lens through which to view the current world and all of the events and challenges that we find ourselves facing, to see if we can come up with new ways to address them.
One of the things that Mr. Goldburn could do, since he is in Morocco, is to make use of his own insights in his conversations with Moroccans. So there is still a role, for individual actors to play some part in attempting to make some changes.
Well, with that, we unfortunately have to close this conversation. It was very rich. Thank you, Travis Adkins and Brenda Gayle Plummer, for sharing your insights and analysis with us. We really appreciate it. To all of you for your questions and comments. Again, I'm sorry we couldn't get to all of you. You can follow Travis Adkins at Travis L. Adkins. That's on Twitter. And our next academic webinar will be on Wednesday, September 29th at 1 p.m. Eastern Time, with Thomas Graham, who is a fellow at CFR, and will talk about Putin's Russia. So in the meantime, I encourage you to follow us at CFR_academic, visit CFR.org, thinkglobalhealth.org, and foreignaffairs.com for new research and analysis on global issues. So thank you all again, and we look forward to continuing the conversation.
Take care, everyone. Thank you.